Attention Buffalo businesses. Did you know that underwriting could get you noticed and recognized from people all throughout the local region? For only a fraction of the cost of what you would pay for commercial radio airtime, 91.3 FM WBMY has been an integral part of the Buffalo community since 1982. But did you know that we are a non-for-profit student-ran organization? And for us to maintain our daily operations, WBMY counts on the student activity fee here at Buffalo State, as well as the contributions from you, the local businesses. For more information, contact the WBMY underwriter at 716-878-3080 or by email at wbmyuwd@gmail.com. And thanks as always for listening to Buffalo's original alternative, 91.3 FM WBNY.
Little ham and eggs coming at you. Hold on, people. Hope you got your griddles.
91.3 FM WBNY, Buffalo's original alternative. Brought to you by the student activity fee here at Buffalo State College.
That's baby making music. That's what that is.
This is All Talk Monday, WBNY's public affairs programming that airs Monday mornings till midnight. The views expressed in all the various All Talk Monday shows are not necessarily those of WBNY, the United Students Government at Buffalo State, or Buffalo State itself. Due to the opinionated nature of these programs, listener discretion is highly advised. If you have any questions or comments about All Talk Monday, you can direct them to WBNY's All Talk Monday, 1300 Elmwood Avenue, Buffalo, New York 14222. For more information, check out our website at wbny.buffalostate.edu, or you may give us a call at the station at 716-878-5104. And take part in all the various All Talk Monday shows.
Broadcast is going out. I don't know who's even listening to me.
91.3 FM WBNY. Are you listening?
Good afternoon, Buffalo State College, Buffalo, and surrounding suburbs. Today is Monday, October 19th, 2015. The time is 2:40. You're listening to Vantage Point, the weekly 2:30 to 4 p.m. show on 91.3 FM WBNY, dedicated to social and environmental justice issues affecting the people of Western New York, not covered by the mainstream media. I am your host, Jack Kanak, also known as the Weather Medic, the Dr. Weather. I am joined today in Studio A by my co-host, WBNY Public Affairs Coordinator, All Talk Monday Coordinator, Jessica Kosick. How are you doing?
I'm doing good.
Great. We're going to talk all about NYPIRG, but first we have on the line Russell Brown. He's from the Western New York Peace Center. He's going to talk about the UNDRO in upstate New York. Russell, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Oh, beautiful. All right. Could you tell us about the walk?
Yeah, well, we just almost completed. We made it to, we're at NCCC. We came from Syracuse, and we're going to they have a drone base out there at Hancock Field, and we've decided to walk to the drone base here in Niagara Falls because they've been assassinating and incinerating people for the past 5 years, and we go there and protest it. Now that they're going to begin to, that's the new mission at the Niagara Falls base. And so we've been there for about a year now with signs waiting for them to start. And pretty soon they're going to start assassinating and incinerating people right here from Niagara Falls. So we wanted to draw a line through it and do little programs along in upstate New York, mostly along 31, at the different towns and colleges. And we did presentations with people and to show the link between the two bases and their role in terrorizing the people of the Middle East.
All right. Can you tell us how did the idea of this walk come to be? I heard it was your idea.
Well, I suggested it last spring, and the group as a whole, we are part of the Upstate Coalition to Ground the Drones and End the Wars. And our website is upstatedroneaction.org. And we do a lot of actions. In fact, two of the people that were on the walk with us, Bonnie and Julian, they had to leave for a day because they had a court appearance in Syracuse for an action at the base. We were all committed to nonviolent response to what the military is doing, and they were there with these giant, beautiful art pieces that we'll have at Hall Walls Tuesday night.
Is that Hall Walls thing open to public?
Yes, it's at 7 p.m. Okay. And Medea Benjamin's going to be the guest speaker. She's been working on the anti-drone stuff for quite a while.
And
she's the head of Code Peak.
Where is that? Is that on Delaware?
It's on Delaware and Tupper, the corner of Delaware and Tupper. Yeah.
Okay. And I guess the question I have is, why is this walk really important to you? What's your role with the Western New York Peace Center, and tell us?
Well, you know, with the Western New York Peace Center, I'm part of the Resist Militarism Task Force, and we're trying to share with people what we know about the increasing militarism in the country and in the police forces, et cetera. And we really oppose the killing by with these MQ-9 Reaper drones, and so we want people to know about it so that they can make a decision to resist it. We don't expect like the president or Congress to discontinue the program. In fact, it works really good for them because they don't have to tell somebody that their son or daughter or husband or wife or whatever came home in a body bag. So, but it's all these other people that are dying, just as many people are dying, if not more. It's just that it's not Americans. And they're sitting here safely in a trailer, you know, following on a screen and seeing people. And I always look at it as three things. One is that, if they were targeting me, and I come into have a cup of coffee at Tim Hortons, that's where I am right now, and so the guy decides to blow me up. Well, all the people in there go with me, you know, and then they don't really know that I'm the person who they thought I was. Reprise came out with a report last November saying that some of the key people, like they say, they got a Taliban leader or an Al-Qaeda leader or some other major leader, and some of them have been killed up to 7 times. So you have to wonder who the other 6 people were that were killed and all the people that were around them that didn't deserve to be killed. You know, I mean, I don't mean anybody deserves to be killed, but I'm just saying, but even if they decided somebody was correct, you know what I mean, they it doesn't get them. And they put across the position that it's real accurate, but it's not. It's only, you know, X amount of accurate. Anyhow. And they do the thing like they had that a few months back. This always stands out in my mind, is that they have a few months back, they had that Jordanian pilot that ISIS burned in a cage. You remember that?
Yep. ISIS tried to get, I guess they tried to outdo each other with street cred, who was the worst torturer.
Okay, so what the reality is, though, is that was, first of all, that was a pilot in a plane going to bomb people.
Right.
He shouldn't have been burned. I'm not saying that, and it is horrible. However, the United States does it all the time. We burn the people. When they hit a pickup truck, they just hit it, and they have that aluminum powder thing that they have inside the Hellfire missiles, and it incinerates the people inside the vehicle, you know, blows them apart. You know, some of their parts escape the vehicle, but they burn it. Or if you see when they hit them on the ground, a group of people, and then they have these burning masses of flesh, you know, and we do it on a really regular basis. And the purpose of drones is to terrorize the people to get them under control.
Right. Well, what people don't realize with the drones is when a drone strikes, they try to take out a actual target. About 90% of the casualties are innocent civilians.
That's correct. Yeah, they just released. Edward Snowden just released the drone papers. And it backed up all the things we've been saying for these years about the military's, they're admitting, the government is admitting that they're killing innocent people. Like you said, 90% of them, the paper says, were innocent people. I haven't got to read the whole thing yet because I've been walking for
right.
days, for weeks.
Right. How many people have joined you on the walk here?
Well, a lot of people. When we started, we had about 40-something, and then, you know, on a lot of days, we have about 8 or 9, you know, because some people have to leave for some meetings and someone else happens to pop in and, you know, it just jumps up and down, you know. So sometimes we have, you know, maybe a dozen people. Sometimes we have 4 or 5, you know, walking. So it varies, you know, and we're hoping a lot of people will come tomorrow to the last day of the walk. We're starting at the gate of Niagara Community College at 11 o'clock, and we're going to walk over to the base. It's not a long walk. It's only about 6 miles. And we have a speaker there. Medea Benz is going to be speaking there. And we have food and this stuff at 5 o'clock, you know, at Kim's place there. So
you're going to meet at the what time you think you're going to get at the main base gate over on Lockport Road, right?
Right. We're going to intentionally. It's on Lockport Road west of Walmore. You know, anyhow, so we want to be there at 3:30. So we'll leave it at 11. So, and, you know, and we'll just try to go a little slower if we're going to get there too early. So we want to make it a thing at 3:30 and hoping people will come, listen to that. And then that night, later in the evening at 7 o'clock at Hall Walls, we're going to have the speaker and, you know, a presentation about drones, which I hope people will come to. It's really she's an informative person and knows a lot about them. And, I think people will be happy to listen to her.
Okay, and once again, give us the website.
UpstateDroneAction.org.
Okay, can you put on Charlie here as I introduce my next guest? It's going to be in Studio B. I've got Patty. I hope I'm saying your name correctly. How do you say your name?
Patty Saravoli. It's a tough one.
Okay. Patty is from the New York Public Interest Research Group. It's NYPIRG. It's a nonpartisan, not-for-profit organization whose mission is to affect policy reforms while training New Yorkers to be citizen advocates. NYPIRG's full-time staff works with citizens, produces studies on a wide range of topics, coordinates state campaigns, engages in public education efforts, and lobbies public officials. So why don't you tell us your background quickly, Patty?
Sure. So I am a Buffalo State alum. I went to school here, got my bachelor's in sociology, and during that time I worked as an intern here on the campus with NYPIRG. I also served on the board of directors as the vice chair during my time as a student. Upon graduation, I started working as the full-time organizer at Buff State for NYPIRG, and now I oversee 9 college campuses and our program on those campuses.
All right, and also I was going to say, because I've got Charlie Bowman on the phone, and he is the head of the Western New York Peace Center Renewable Energy Task Force, and I thought we'd start by talking with you and him on REV, which is Reforming the Energy Vision. Charlie, you're there.
I'm here.
All right. All right, I'll go ahead and wait. Oh, geez. Hold on, Charlie.
Okay.
Patty, can you just move a bit closer to the mic?
Absolutely.
Because we were trying to get you to move closer to the mic, but your door's locked.
Oh, gotcha.
So we couldn't go in there. So get just a little bit closer to the mic, scooch up to it, and then you'll be coming in fine.
How's that?
Just a little bit closer there.
How about now?
All right, how's that sound, guys?
That's perfect.
All right. Charlie, you there?
I'm here.
Okay, let's talk about renewing the energy vision. I was going to say, unless Jessica wants to start going on New York is only contemplating how to respond to the climate change menace, but is also trying to move its energy system into the digital age.
Under the current utility structure, the power sector in New York is on track to spend an estimated $30 billion to replace and modernize the state's aging energy infrastructure over the next decade. Unless the state makes changes, that $30 billion investment will increase costs to ratepayers and perpetuate the use of an outdated, inefficient polluting system. Fortunately, the need to modernize the state's energy system dovetails with the goal of developing policies that encourage energy use reduction, efficiency measures, and the move to reliance on alternative energy sources such as solar power. In New York, the proposed solution is the state's reforming the Energy Vision Plan under active development before the state's Public Service Commission. REV holds great promise for overhauling the state's rickety energy infrastructure, placing a priority of energy use reduction and efficiency, promoting renewable energy production, and building system reliability.
Oh, okay, who wants to add on to that? Patty or Charlie, go ahead.
Well, when the Public Service Commission came here last January, I attended the hearings along with many other groups, the Sierra Club and Push Buffalo, and we were very concerned about their presentation on renewing the energy vision. And part of their vision is to continue with nuclear power, continue with coal power, continue with oil and kerosene, continue with fossil fuels. And that is something that we cannot afford to do anymore. That all this has to stop pretty soon, because we don't have we're dumping all the CO2 into the atmosphere. We're having nuclear accidents around the world. Fukushima, these major accidents happen every once in a while, and they're still trying to shut down the reactors in Fukushima. It's still a dangerous situation over there after 2 years, and so we have to stop nuclear, and we should not be burning any more coal. And all of this was missed by the Public Service Commission, and they were told repeatedly that last January. And they're grudgingly going towards renewable energy, but we need a massive build-out of solar. We need a massive build-out of wind. And we need a massive build-out of geothermal. And this has to occur very soon. And the plan to do that, it's technically feasible. Jacobson and his colleagues from Cornell, from Stanford University, they all agree that it is technically feasible. And it just needs, the political will needs to be there. Hello?
Yeah, we're back here, Charlie. We're just getting some people in from NYPERG here. Patty, do you have a comment on what Charlie was saying? Did you catch some of it, reforming the energy vision?
One thing that I would add to what we've said thus far is not only is reforming the energy vision, not only are the goals aimed at increasing efficiency, increasing the amount of sustainable energy, but also keeping in mind the ratepayers and making sure that energy is affordable for the consumers all across New York State.
Well, that's true, and the Public Service Commission is moving in that direction.
Mm-hmm.
They issued rulings this summer allowing renters in New York City, allowing renters in Buffalo, wherever, to purchase solar panels on a solar farm, say, in the rural areas of, Southern Tier or in the Adirondacks, and appropriately crediting the bill. Mm-hmm. And that process has begun, and that's good. That's a major deal, and that will help make it affordable. And I'll say one thing. If we don't, this has to be paid for, and there are ways of doing it. And the Peace Center and the Renewable Energy Task Force favors the reduction, heavy reduction in military money, military spending, and devoting a lot of that towards build-out of renewable energy systems across the country. And, you know, one of our plans that we'll talk about tomorrow at the Niagara Falls Air Base is, you know, our plant, you know, should be turned into a gigantic solar farm, as we've been promoting that for the last few years now. And we'll talk again about it tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Certainly.
Hello?
Yeah, hello. Go ahead, Patty.
So I also have Avery, one of the students from NYPIRG that has been involved in the REV process and in organizing here on the campus. And he spoke recently at the low to moderate income REV proceedings. So I thought it would be interesting to get his viewpoint on the process thus far and his experience there. Yeah.
Yeah, so the Reform Energy Vision was brought to my attention, I would say, last year. So I was still learning more about it and far as the goals of it. So at the hearing, I was just speaking on behalf of myself and on behalf of students or anyone in the area who are going to be paying these energy bills and whatnot. And I believe through the REV initiative, we will be able to make progress as far as, you know, using renewable energy and also paying less for our energy sources.
Mm-hmm. And it's imperative, too, that that citizens all across New York State are involved in this process in order for it to, the potential of the REV proceedings to be fully realized. You know, we need every single person to weigh in on REV and give their experiences and what they would like to see from the process and how they see our future in New York State, our energy future in New York State.
All right. Charlie, we have to take a break for news, and then we're going to be back here right after the news, all right?
Okay.
And just so hold on. I'm going to be doing the news right now. This is ABC News Now.
ABC News, I'm Joan Bennett. Drone operators are on notice. They could soon be required to register their unmanned aircraft. A national registry for drones is in the works to make flying multi-copters safer for the general public, including passenger planes. A high school kid allegedly broke into CIA Director John Brennan's personal email account. ABC's senior justice correspondent Pierre Thomas.
This young hacker told the New York Post that he infiltrated a private email account of CIA Director John Brennan. The explosive allegation include claims that the hacker got access to Brennan's application for a security clearance and private information about other top intelligence officials.
A federal appeals court has upheld key provisions of New York and Connecticut laws banning possession of semi-automatic assault weapons and large-capacity magazines. A Navy ship is heading out from Virginia today to search for the missing cargo ship El Faro that sank in the Atlantic during Hurricane Joaquin with 33 crew members on board. This is ABC News. It's Teen Driver Safety Week, and there's a new survey on teen driving. ABC's Dave Schreiber with a story.
Safety experts say in the U.S., motor vehicle accidents are still the number one cause of death for teens. Preliminary 2015 data show things could get worse. Governor's Highway Safety Association spokeswoman Kara Masick.
Traffic fatalities, after, you know, huge reductions and great reductions in the past, are going up again, and part of that is attributable to the improved economy.
Masick says high school coaches and other adults in teens' lives can help teach valuable lessons about safe driving. Dave Schreiber, ABC News.
Texas announcing today that it's cutting off Medicaid funding to Planned Parenthood clinics following undercover videos of officials discussing fetal tissue. That's potentially triggering a legal fight like the one unfolding in neighboring Louisiana, where a judge today ruled that Louisiana must continue providing Medicaid funding. Joan Bennett, ABC News.
All right, and now here's the weather. Currently, we're 56 degrees, mostly cloudy and breezy at the Buffalo Greater International Airport. Humidity 34%, wind southwest at 23, gusting to 32, barometer 30.17 inches of mercury. The dew point is a very chilly 28. The forecast for this afternoon, they're calling really right now mostly sunny, but we probably have those high clouds, so it is sunny out there. A high near 53, breezy southwest wind 18, well, they say 53, we're already at 56. Southwest wind 18 to 20. That's how they update it at the Weather Service. Tonight, mostly cloudy, low of 51. Breezy southwest wind 22 to 24. On Tuesday, a chance of showers, mainly before 1, mostly cloudy, a high near 61, breezy with a southwest wind, 16 to 20 miles per hour, chance of precipitation 30%, new precipitation amounts less than a tenth of an inch possible. Tuesday night, a chance of showers, cloudy, low around 50, southwest winds 5 to 7 miles per hour, chance of precipitation 20%. Wednesday, a chance of showers, mainly before 5 o'clock, cloudy with a high of 63. Southwest winds down to 6 miles an hour. Chance of precipitation, 50%. New precipitation amounts less than a tenth of an inch possible. Okay, and we're going to be back to Vantage Point here right coming up right in a second. All right, and we're back here on Vantage Point with Charlie Bowman on the phone and Patty Saravoli.
Yeah.
Okay, and who's the guest, other guests in the studio there? We haven't met you.
My name is Avery Edwards. I'm a Buffalo State student, sophomore sociology major.
Okay. Beautiful. All right, Charlie, you still there?
I'm still here.
All right, beautiful. We're talking about reforming the energy vision. Why don't you go and pick it up, Charlie, with your thought?
Well, I the reforming the energy vision is a baby step in the right direction, and we really need a massive build out of solar, wind, and geothermal infrastructure in New York State and the other 49 states. I mean, this can't be put off any longer. We can't afford that. Human beings are in an emergency situation in terms of future human evolution on Earth. As the Pope said, God forgives, but the Earth does. You know, Mother Earth does not. That's a paraphrase from the Pope. But we are endangering the human species by continuing this massive pollution of methane in the atmosphere, of CO2 in the atmosphere, and we really have to begin massive reductions of those pollutants. And the only way to do that is through solar, wind, and geothermal build-out. And that will create, as the Jacobson paper has shown, that will create, 300,000 new jobs in New York State, and a corresponding number in New England states. And the Jacobson paper has job details for all the other 49 states. So all these numbers are known, but the media has, with the exception of WBNY, has effectively shut down conversation on this. The Pope's message really has to be paid attention to.
All right, Charlie, I was just going to also say that there's an excellent website that NYPERG has on about reforming the energy vision, and it's beautifully written. I'm going to have to send you the link because it's just fantastic. I was looking at it last night, and it was well written and well explained. Go ahead, Patty. You have.
Sure. So in addition to the NYPERG website, we do also have a report that we published, a 42-page report that is a guide to help New Yorkers understand the REV proceedings and how to get involved. It's called Energy Crossroads, and it's probably available right through the website on the page that talks about REV.
Okay, great. I'll look forward to that. And I just want to say that my wife and I have been members of NYPERG for many years.
Thank you so much for that, Charlie. It's a pleasure to be on the radio with you.
Jack, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still there. It's Charlie, okay. Thanks a lot, and we got some other issues to get to.
Okay.
But thanks a lot for being on today, and just want to give the telephone number here, 878-5104, and also our website, which I don't know what to do with my thing here. It's www.buffalostate. Help me out here. It used to be WBNY.org, but they changed the server. Oh, there it is. They put out WBNY.buffalostate.edu. There you go.
Okay. It was, thanks, Jack.
It was changed. Charlie, thank you very much. Bye bye.
Okay, thank you. Bye bye.
Okay, so we got. I just have to play some announcements here, and then while we set up in Studio B here, we're going to go and get back to the show on Vantage Point here on 91.3 WBNY Buffalo.
Were you born from 1945 to 1965? People born during these years are 5 times more likely to have hepatitis C, but most people don't know they are infected. So even if you try to eat right, exercise, and take care of yourself, you can still have hepatitis C, a serious liver disease that often has no symptoms. In fact, people can live with hepatitis C for decades without feeling or looking sick. But over time, hepatitis C can cause serious health problems, including liver damage, liver failure, or even liver cancer. Getting tested is the only way to know if you're infected with hepatitis C. That's why the CDC recommends everyone born from 1945 to 1965 get a blood test for hepatitis C. Treatments are available that can cure this disease. So talk to your doctor about getting tested. It could save your life. A message from the CDC.
Getting a tattoo is a big decision. It's not something to trust just any tattoo shop with. Rise Above has a new and improved shop to go along with their clean and friendly atmosphere. No matter what you choose to put on your skin, their award-winning artists can get the job done. Rise Above Classic Tattooing is located at 2289 Delaware Avenue. Open Monday through Saturday, 12 to 8 p.m. For more information, give them a call at 874-1675. And remember, walk-ins are always welcome.
91.3 FM WBNY, Buffalo's original alternative. Brought to you by the student activity fee here at Buffalo State College. This is All Talk Monday, WBNY's public affairs programming that airs Monday mornings till midnight. The views expressed in all the various All Talk Monday shows are not necessarily those of WBNY, the United Students Government at Buffalo State, or Buffalo State itself. Due to the opinionated nature of these programs, listener discretion is highly advised. If you have any questions or comments about All Talk Monday, you can direct them to WBNY's All Talk Monday, 1300 Elmwood Avenue, Buffalo, New York, 14222. For more information, check out our website at wbny.buffalostate.edu, or you may give us a call at the station at 716-878-5104 and take part in all the various All Talk Monday shows.
All right, and we're back here on 91.3 WBNY Buffalo. All right, so we have some new guests. We have, besides Patty, we have Maddie, and we have Avery. So go ahead, Patty, tell us what you do at NYPIRG.
At NYPIRG, I personally oversee 9 of the campus programs on campuses across the state. So our goal, though, NYPIRG as a whole, it's a dual mission. The first thing is to affect positive policy reform. And the second thing is to work to train students and community members on how to run and implement these campaigns and make that positive policy change. So we work on a range of different issues, including the environment, obviously, as we spoke about Rev earlier, higher education affordability, hunger and homelessness prevention, consumer advocacy, government reform, and I believe that's all. Oh, voter mobilization is the last.
All right. And then besides Patty, we have Maddie. Go ahead to tell us what you do at NYPIRG.
So I am the project leader this semester for the Higher Education Affordability Campaign here at Buff State. And so a little background about our higher education affordability. So since 2008, state funding for higher education in New York has been cut significantly. And at the same time, annual tuition hikes, which is part of the New York SUNY 2020 law, have caused college tuition to skyrocket, increasing by over 1,500 in just 5 years. So together, tuition hikes and funding cuts have shifted the burden of paying for college from state on to students and their families. And on top of that, the tuition increases are outpacing wage growth, making growing student loan debt even harder to pay off. So what we're trying to do here at NYPIRG is once the SUNY 2020 law expires and the debate on what to do next is heating up, SUNY 2020 has left students with broken promises and higher tuition rates. So with many students struggling to afford rising tuition and student loan debt, we're going to try to get this freeze tuition sign-on letter, which we just need an e-board member's signature, and we also are getting students to sign this petition. We need about 25,000 signatures statewide, 2,000 here at Buff State, and actually tomorrow in the student union, me and a couple of other kids that I work with on this will be having a freeze tuition event where kids can come cut out snowflakes, write on the snowflake why we should freeze tuition. We're going to take their picture with them, and we're going to be there to answer questions and inform the students on exactly what's going on and also get their signatures for this great petition.
All right. Well, I'm going to ask you some more questions later. I have some questions about the 2020 thing. It's not doesn't have to do with eyes and what the governor was trying to do. But we're going to let Avery talk about environmental issues, what he's doing.
All right. So last year, I just pretty much volunteered with NYPIRG, and I did help out with the environmental campaign. But this semester and this year, I plan on running the campaign for the environmental section of our chapter. And pretty much what we're going to be focusing on is the Rev comments. Pretty much we're going to have people voice their opinions, give their ideas about the Rev initiative that we are pushing forward. That's pretty much what we're going to be working on for the environmental campaign at Buff State.
All right. So let me get back here and talk about some education stuff here. Mm-hmm. Let's start with supporting the New York State Dream Act.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that.
Awesome. So the New York State Dream Act would extend the tuition assistance program to undocumented students in New York State. Currently, those individuals have to pay for their college education on their own. They have no form of loans that they can apply for. They can't apply for any type of state or federal funding. So this would allow nearly 5,000 students a year to receive at least some assistance to gaining a college education. It's a wonderful piece of legislation that we've worked on for quite a few years, and we're working to, again, mobilize students on the campuses across New York to demand that the DREAM Act is passed in the 2016 legislative session.
Sounds good. Mm-hmm. Let's hope it gets some movement in both the Assembly and the Senate and the government. Governor signs it.
Mm-hmm. Typically in the Assembly, we usually do have some version of the bill that passes, but it does stall in the Senate every legislative session, unfortunately.
The Senate tends to be more conservative.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right. How about talking? Now, see, when I went to school here
mm-hmm.
back in the 1980s, okay, my tuition was $500 a semester. And it cost me about $100 for books. And that was it. There's no debt.
Mm-hmm.
There's no debt. But now you let's talk about restoring and protecting TAP, which is a tuition assistance program.
Mm-hmm.
I actually got $400 in TAP,
mm-hmm.
and the tuition was $500 a year. So I actually, yeah.
Were you full-time?
Yeah, full-time.
That's the only way you can get TAP.
That's amazing.
Full-time. Yeah. So it cost me... It costs me $100 a year for tuition and $100 a year for books. Not a year, a semester. And what I did was I'm the weather guy. So I did weather instruments on the campus, changed all the charts, fixed all the instruments. They gave me $100 a year for that. So it only cost me like $300 a year to go here, which is like...
You didn't have Pell?
What?
You didn't have any Pell back then?
Yeah, well, yeah, but I was getting 400 out of 500 through TAP.
But you could have gotten the rest in Pell.
We're only talking a couple hundred bucks here. We're not, you know, it didn't break me.
Every student listening to this show right now is writing with jealousy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, no, that's how it was. And mm-hmm. in the day, I could take a bus from my house to North Tonawanda,
mm-hmm.
100 yards from my house, 35 cents one way, 35 cents back.
Oh my
to Buff State, and it dropped me off right at Rockwell Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And now I have to walk 2 miles to the bus.
Well, let's put this into perspective. What was minimum wage back then?
$3.35 an hour.
Okay, so everything has risen.
Except really minimum wage. Yeah. Why one of the topics I want to bring up after this is a $15 minimum wage, so then people can pay for college education.
Absolutely.
Also, graduate school's way down. People can't get into master's programs, mm-hmm. not because they don't want to, it's they can't afford the extra debt.
Right, and TAP actually used to be available to graduate students, and it's no longer available after 2008.
One of them is?
I think Pell, I believe Pell is available for graduate students, but not the state tuition assistance program. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, even when I was here as a student, you know, the $600, Jack, that you paid sounds so great. But even when I was here, I graduated in 2011, tuition was almost $1,500 less as
right.
well.
I mean, it's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely crazy.
Right. And although the cost of everything has increased, you know, the funding structures and the assistance that the state and the federal government offers have not maintained rising with the cost of other things.
Well, absolutely. How do we protect, I guess, the funding for higher education? What is already, how do we protect what we got so we don't lose more?
There are a few ways that students can make sure that they're, you know, represented better on issues like higher education affordability. The first thing that comes to my mind is registering to vote and getting out there and voting on Election Day. You know, students are one of the least active voting blocks in the entire country, 18 to 24-year-olds. And we have bad representation because of that. You know, think about how many students are on this college campus. I think the numbers hit like 12,000 or 13,000. If every single person on this campus registered to vote and went out on November 2nd and casted their ballot, they could change the outlook for our legislature completely. So I think that's one of the most important things. Also, you know, getting on board with our higher education affordability campaign is a great way to have your voice heard. You heard Maddie talk about the tuition freeze petition, and that is something we're doing on all 17 campuses across New York. Our goal, as she mentioned, is getting 25,000 students signed on to that. And when we go to Albany in February, as we do every year, to lobby on higher education affordability, where there are hundreds of students that come together for this day, when we go to Albany, when we present those 25,000 petitions, when we have hundreds of student voices there to speak their mind, that really works to get the attention of our elected officials, senators and assemblymen, and even the governor. So that's another great option. And, you know, we meet on Tuesdays at 5 p.m. in the Campbell Student Union, room 419. That's a great way to find out both about how to get registered to vote, you know, who's running in the elections, when election day is, and how to get more involved in the higher education campaign.
And remember, we got to give a plug to Wesley.
Yes.
Wesley Thomas, because he's the guy running it here locally at Buffalo State College, where you're the regional.
Mm-hmm. Is that just take over this semester, right?
Wesley took over for Julia
White.
White.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so Wesley's the guy here this semester.
Is he still going through classes? Like I remember I know Julia White's voice and her name based on, because she would always come into classes and like speak for like the teachers would give her like 5 minutes and she would speak so fast.
Yeah, Wesley's our full-time staff person. He's not a student on campus, but he does go into classes every single day. I think at this point he is presented in over 80 classes on campus, and he'll continue to do that throughout this semester and next semester. On various issues, you know, touching on voter mobilization, higher education, and all the things we'll discuss here today.
All right. I had the applause set up for you, but I forgot to give you the applause when I introduced you. So
that's exciting.
Yeah. So we're gonna play the applause right now. All right.
Hopefully.
Thank you.
We have like 5 million people in the studio listening to us. So that's all it is. So anyhow, all right. Could you since we're on education, mm-hmm. and before the break, let's talk about the SUNY 2020 and the maintenance of effort.
Yeah, absolutely. That is a great campaign. We are teaming up with the faculty and staff unions across the state, both within SUNY and CUNY. So here at Buffalo State, we're working with UUP, the United University Professions, the teachers union, on a postcard drive, which is in support of the maintenance of effort. So as part of SUNY 2020, when this was put in place, it said that tuition would increase every single year $300 for the students, but at the same time, it promised that the state funding would be maintained at its current level. Now, unfortunately, over the last 4 years since that was put in place, we have not seen the state maintain the amount of money for the SUNY and CUNY system. So this postcard drive is in support of the state fulfilling their commitment to the maintenance of effort. You know, we've seen with the tuition increases, rather than that going towards lowering class size, towards bringing in more full-time staff on the campuses and really just bettering the academic programs, we've seen that instead fill the budget gap that the state is required by law to fulfill.
All right, Jessica, do you have a question?
So as you were saying about, did you go over anything to do with the textbook link that I have?
I did not talk about textbooks, but I could definitely go into that. We did put out a report last year about textbook prices, and we surveyed to see if students were foregoing purchasing textbooks because of the price, and we found overwhelmingly that many students passed up getting some, if not all, of their textbooks because they couldn't afford the price of them. That textbooks report can also be found on our website. But as I'm sure you know, Jessica, the price of textbooks is ever increasing, and it's a lot of money for these students. So, you know, our goal is to find a way to decrease the burden on students financially and allow them to be able to get these textbooks because, you know, they're required for the courses. We need these in order to, you know, fully recognize and fully appreciate the courses we're taking.
I know that over the last couple of semesters, at least, I don't know, because I'm lonely looking at the last, like, two, maybe 3 years of school. I know renting a textbook is now, that's what I usually do in all my classes.
Yeah, renting a textbook, it's a really great option, and obviously it is much more affordable. I think on this campus, it's typically like $50 to rent a textbook. But for many of the students, you know, they, at the end of the course, if they're within their major, these are great resources for them to carry with them into their professional career. So although, you know, it is a good option, it's more affordable to rent these textbooks, you know, the preferable, what is preferable is to be able to purchase that textbook and hold on to it for use in our career in the future.
All right. I got a question for Maddie. I don't know if she could answer about federal higher education issues. How does the federal government play into all this? Because what people don't realize out there that don't have debt and really don't care about this is that students, you cannot declare bankruptcy if you have a lot of debt. I mean, you are just literally thrown under the bus and you have to pay that debt out, which unfortunately... You can't declare Chapter 7 or 11 or whatever chapter you want to declare.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's why student loan debt is $1.3 trillion. I mean, these lenders are willing to hand out amounts of money to students who are in need. These students aren't aware of what it's going to be like once they graduate. And I mean, earlier what you asked, how does the federal government come into play with this? I mean, there's federal loans that you can get. I know I have federal loans and I will eventually have to pay those out, and you are right, you can't declare bankruptcy on a student loan, and that's why they just are at $1.3 trillion. Like, that number is just unbelievable.
Are the forgiveness programs actually working?
I'm not sure. Do you know anything about that?
That's a good question. I don't know anything about I don't know the hard numbers on how effective they've been, but that said, you know, they are definitely too limited. For example, I know one of the programs is set up for individuals that work within nonprofits, 501c3s, and if you pay your loans for 10 years on time, every single month, whatever is left over after that 10-year period is forgiven. But, you know, during that 10 years, you can't have one single late payment. And, you know, that's tough. And working within a nonprofit, you're, you know, not necessarily raking in the money.
Sure. Well, no.
Right. So there's, you know, the chances that
you don't go out to the tree and pick it off the tree. Yeah.
Right. So you could be 9 years into the forgiveness program.
Miss one payment.
Miss one payment, be a day late, and you have to start that 10-year period over. Oh, so it's great that they're in place.
Jessica is turning colors here in the other room.
It is scary, and, you know, as Maddie said, that $1.3 trillion in student loan debt is overwhelming. It's the biggest debt in the country as of right now. You know, it's surpassed credit card debt, you know, mortgage debt. It leaves me speechless, you know.
I'm over here overwhelmed.
Well, what I was going to say is I have to take a break here coming up. And we're going to be back, and we got a minute and 22, and then we'll be back after these announcements on 91.3 WBNY Buffalo. Go ahead.
Since 1982, it's WBNY, baby. Lend an ear, and you'll hear all about a beer for here. We're sincere,
located at 15 Lafayette Avenue, Community Beer Works, Bill's Growlers, 3 to 7 p.m. Thursdays and Fridays, and at Bidwell's Farmers Market on Saturdays. For more information, go to communitybeerworks.com. Cheers!
So here's three cheers for local beers.
Beer, beer, beer!
Community Beer Works!
Hi, my name's Bob. I see this ad on TV, says I can reduce my debt by 50%. I call, they told me to stop paying my bills, stop talking to my creditors, they'd take care of everything.
I gave them thousands, but most of it went to their fees.
Getting out of debt is neither quick nor easy. There are those who will tell you anything to win your trust.
I'm more in debt now because the fees and interest on my cards kept piling up.
Talk to your creditors directly or to find a nonprofit agency near you. Visit debtadvice.org. This has been a public service message.
All right, we're back here on Vantage Point on 91.3 WBNY Buffalo. Phone number here, 878-5104, 878-5104, if you want to talk to our guests from NYPERC, which is Patty, Maddie, and Avery. And also Jessica Kosick's in the studio. I'll talk Monday, Public Affairs Coordinator, and myself, and Paul Smith, our chief
Paul
engineer,
Smith is here.
Just walked in.
There's nothing subtle about
it. We love you, Paul.
Yeah. Yeah. There you go. And Jess is here, and Jess is...
Another Jess. We're training her.
Yeah, we're training her. So
if you've seen any, if you heard any different kind of confusion coming from this show, it's just because we're training.
Training, yes. Yes. You could work the computer, Paul.
Can I?
Yes, you can work the computer. Go ahead.
Take it offline.
I got to take it offline? Okay.
Okay.
All right. Let me just take it offline for Paul, and let's get to voting, because
yeah,
Jessica's
voting.
Been a big thing about voting. So
just this semester.
Yeah. Let's talk about voting and why students don't vote, and why don't they register? Why don't they vote more frequently? If they voted as a block, it would be much.
What's happening?
Uh-oh.
It happened?
Oh, wait a minute. I'll
you
tune it off. We have little gremlins here at WBNY.
You're
going to
be gremlins.
We're rocking here at WBNY.
It's about 6 foot four, this gremlin. Sorry.
That's all right. That's all right.
You told me it was offline.
I thought with the computer, I got you now.
To really screw things up, you need an engineer.
Okay. Well, you are the engineer.
Okay, carry on, right?
Okay, we'll carry on with voting. Well, hey, this is a gem of a show, so we'll carry on with voting. Why don't students vote? Why don't they register? Why don't they get out there as a block?
Maddie Avery, do you guys want to comment on that?
I can comment on that. Why don't students vote? I would say because most of them aren't registered. I don't know why students don't like to register, but this semester, what we've been doing, well, with NYPERG, we actually have been registering people to vote. And, you know, most of them, they just don't want to get involved in the politics. They say that their voice doesn't matter. You know, I believe that's nonsense. You know, personally, I believe that everyone has a voice in the political agendas that, you know, we live by. We don't make the decisions for ourselves, but we do choose who makes the decisions for us. And you know, I don't know why. I honestly don't know why people don't want to vote.
Kids are just more concerned with other things. A lot of them, I've gotten answers like, oh, I don't believe in the systems. And the thing is, the system works. You just got to use your born rights to actually choose who represents you, like Avery said.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, as I mentioned earlier, 18 to 24-year-olds are the least active voting bloc. They're, you know, the population that the least amount of people are registered for, but even those that are registered don't often get out there and act. And take advantage of their right to vote. And you know, before 1920, women didn't have the right to vote. Minorities didn't have the right to vote. There are so many people that have come before us and fought for every single person listening to this show, every person 18 and over, to have the right to get their voice heard in government and to weigh in on the issues that matter to them. So, you know, Avery and Maddie have been working quite a bit on this campus, very hard to get as many students registered to vote as possible. They registered close to 900 students this semester, and wow, statewide, about 15,000 students have been registered. So I think, and I hope, that things are starting to take a turn. You know, the younger generation is getting more involved in politics and in the issues that matter to them. So, you know, hopefully in coming years, with the work of students like Maddie and Avery, we can ensure that we students are the most active voting bloc rather than the least active voting bloc.
Well, go ahead, Jessica.
I think some of the bigger things that, like, I know I've only recently started getting into the politics over the last, like, maybe 6 months. Mm-hmm. Before that, I wasn't even, maybe I was registered. I registered, but I'm not even sure which party I was voting or registered, because I registered a couple different times. Mm-hmm. But the biggest...
The Gandhi party of 2 million. 2 billion or whatever.
I think my biggest reason was I didn't feel like, one, that my voice counted, and two, I didn't think that I knew enough about what I was doing in order to even vote. I figured that it would just be like an ignorant vote. And I think that a lot of the different people that I've actually talked to over the last couple of months think the same thing.
Absolutely. that's what it is. I feel like, personally, a lot of people are, you know, not informed enough as to what's going on, and not informed on the candidates, not informed on their platforms for their campaigns and whatnot. So we, working with NYPER, we really want to inform people on the political agendas.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And you know, one thing that I like to say is that the only time your vote doesn't count is when you don't cast your vote.
Yeah.
So, you know, people that try to say that their voice doesn't count or their vote doesn't matter, if you're not casting the ballot, it doesn't. So I really encourage students, community members, you guys in the other studio, if you're not registered already, please get registered.
The mm-hmm. You've already expired. The date was the
right.
couple weeks
Wait,
ago.
Weeks ago?
Yeah. October 9th.
So you can't register if you're not. You can't vote now.
Right.
But you can still register if you'd like to vote for the presidential.
Yes, next year.
Right,
next year.
Exactly. The time period has passed for this November election, and this is it gets a little bit confusing. So the presidential primaries are coming up in April. Anybody that has never been registered or is a new resident to the state of New York can still register to vote in those primaries in April. But if you were previously registered in New York in a party, you cannot re-register. So first-time voters can still register for the presidential primaries in April. Everyone can still register for the general elections.
For next year,
yeah. Correct.
Right. I think if the students understood that a lot of the, I'm gonna say Democratic, and this could be wild to say. A lot of the Democratic presidents that are running as candidates, most of them have the tuition, free tuition in their plan. And even one of them, who would reach the Green Party?
Who was here last week?
Anthony Boehner.
Anthony,
but who was
Zany,
he talking
Anthony
about?
Boehner, yeah.
The lady that he was talking about that's running, she's the only person running for a Green Party.
Oh, Jill something.
Jill Stein.
Jill Stein.
Actually wants free tuition, and she wants to take care of the tuition that other people already have, like the past debt that they have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that would be awesome.
That would be so fantastic. And to be honest, you know, if we were a more active voting bloc, if students were a more active voting bloc, you'd see that on every single candidate's platform. And it would be, you know, priority number one. With that $1.3 trillion in debt, it should be priority number one for every single person running for the presidency, running for the state legislature. You know, this should be one of the hot button issues. But unfortunately,
if no one comes out, it's not on the radar.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be. You have to have a block of people that, hey, we have to go and get this done, mm-hmm. and then it's going to be on the radar.
Mm-hmm. Right. Students have to mobilize.
Yep.
If we want action on these issues, then we need to demand action by getting out there and voting, by calling our state representatives, senators, and assemblymen, and even reaching out to the presidential candidates. You know, our elected officials, they listen to what people have to say, but when there are hundreds or thousands or hundreds of thousands of people reaching out to them on a single issue, that's what's going to give us progress on the issue.
I think it would help if as the generations are getting younger and younger and younger, they're going more towards technology and less towards like radio, like we are here, or even going and watching like news and stuff like these things that the kids aren't doing anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would help if we wanted more people to actually register and to care,
mm-hmm.
to try to find ways to appeal to them, like through technology, or like I don't know exactly what that would be, but finding ways to make the 18-year-olds like think about things.
Yeah, absolutely. Harnessing social media could be a vital tool for any person running for an elected office. Jessica, you said like 6 months or so you've been involved in politics. Was there anything that worked for you to get you involved in politics in the last 6 months? Was it social media? Was it?
I think social media, there's going to be a new thing. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is, mm-hmm. but there's going to be a new thing. And social media, like MySpace is irrelevant now. But
mm-hmm.
For me, it was thinking about tuition and the views based on like the government wanting to tell females what they can do with their bodies, mm-hmm. and things that were like, as I started growing up and maturing, the things that were close to my heart.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's the tuition.
Well, that's a scary issue, and one that, you know, so many people are facing issues with. I graduated from Buff State, and I have three times the average student loan debt as, you know, a typical student graduating state schools. So I am with you, and I'm terrified.
I had no debt until I decided I was going to go in for my bachelor's, and I came in with my associates, and now I'm getting ready to start the paperwork and everything for graduate school, and as everybody's talking about the tuition, my head was exploding.
Well, I'm going to make sure that you get information about our higher education action day. It's bringing students down to Albany to talk to their senators and assemblymen about higher education affordability, and TAP extending that back to graduate students is a key thing. And, you know, the best part of the Higher Education Action Day is that the stories from the students are really moving to the senators and assemblymen. Typically, they have lobbyists sitting in their office spewing numbers at them and things like that. So when they can hear from one of their constituents and hear the ways that, the cost of education has affected them, it makes a really big difference.
The only thing I could say is
silence.
Oh no.
That's what he's got.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh no. Oh no.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Oh no.
That was kind of funny, you know. Gotta have a little humor on the show, you know. Can you tell me, with voting, why do people vote against their own self-interest? They seem to be voting on these fringe issues, and it's unfortunately against people's self-interest.
Mm-hmm. Before they answer, can you explain to the 101 viewers what a fringe issue is?
Oh, a fringe issue would be like, there's a close election and somebody will bring out an abortion issue. Mm-hmm. And then it will get this entire block of people that would get upset about it, and their candidate will get in. And the candidate you really want to get in won't get in just because of a fringe issue like abortion. We're talking about gun control, mm-hmm. is another issue that will just get a block of people mobilized.
Mm-hmm. That's a good question.
They seem to do that on close election. They'll bring up a proposition, especially in California, they'll bring that up.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll get a block of people out there.
So, I mean, I think the biggest problem with that is the lack of participation from, people either in a state or across the country. You know, as we said, and we've said a few times, 18 to 24-year-olds are the least active voting bloc. So, of course, we don't hear about higher education on a regular basis from the media. Instead, we hear about these emotional issues that, they, for whatever reason, pique people's interest. It's something that is just... It agitates people, and that's what they focus on. But if we want better representation, if we want action on the issues that we care most about, it's important to mobilize, vote, and let people know that we are watching.
Does NYPERG ever go into the high schools?
We do go into the high schools, not typically for voter registration, only because most of the students are a little bit too young for that. But we've organized to do class presentations on the different campaigns. For example, last year, I believe in this area, I forget what high school it was, but one of the ones very close to campus, we went in and presented on reforming the energy vision.
McKinley? That's close here.
McKinley.
That's on Elmwood.
That's the one on Elmwood. It wasn't that one.
Oh, there's Lafayette. That's close to here.
Maybe Lafayette.
It was a Buffalo public school.
A Buffalo public school, oh, okay. Yeah. So, you know, we'll report to the high school students on one of the campaigns we're working on, how they can get involved in that. And we do, over the summer, we have a different program that we run, and that one is an education and fundraising campaign. So we typically will go out to high schools and work to recruit students to become a part of that program. So there are a few ways we reach out to high school students.
I think that it would be really cool if there was a program that NYPERG went through for seniors and getting them involved and helping them do some kind of campaign. Mm-hmm. And then we could even bring them into here for WBNY and have them talk about the things that they learned or things that would have appealed to them before that point.
Yeah, absolutely. We do work a lot with coalitions across the state. And, you know, I'm thinking specifically for the voter mobilization campaign. We work with organizations like the League of Women Voters and Citizens Action, and these organizations pull in, different demographic of people. With the League of Women Voters, it is typically an older population, and we've worked with them to do voter mobilization this semester and in previous years. So I agree, being able to learn from different groups of people and different organizations definitely helps us to sort of figure out where we need to focus the different campaigns.
I think students helping students would be a really good idea.
Mm-hmm, certainly.
Because nobody understands what the students are thinking more than other students.
Mm-hmm. It's very true.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, we're running up against the clock here in a couple minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Just a closing remark, I guess, what you would like to see happen here at the anything at the campus, anything on your mind we haven't got to. And then I want you to finally, the last thing, give your website. How do people get in touch with NYPIRG here on campus? Tell everybody it's room 419 at Student Union, in case they want to hook up with NYPIRG and they find this very interesting, because the more people, the better.
Awesome.
So go ahead, I guess, Patty or Maddie or Avery, however you want to do it.
So one thing that I did want to mention is we haven't touched on this, but our consumer advocacy campaign, we just premiered a new campaign within the last year, and that is working to label genetically modified organisms, products with genetically modified organisms or GMOs. So that is one of our newest, most exciting campaigns. It's gone very well on the campuses thus far. It's an issue that students really seem to be interested in. So that is one of the big efforts that we'll start working on during the legislative session come January. And this is really a right to know campaign. So it's not, it doesn't relate to environmental. We're not talking about environmental impacts of GMOs. We're really just talking about consumers having the right to know what it is they're buying and what they're consuming. So I just wanted to plug that one really quick because it is a very exciting campaign. And also, just one thing I wanted to impart on everybody listening, everyone in the studio today, is to make sure that on November 2nd, you get out there and cast your ballot and vote.
It's November 3rd.
November 3rd. That's what I said.
November. If you're there the 2nd, you're going to be early.
Thank you for checking and correcting me. November 3rd. And if you do live here on campus, your polling place is the Assarisi Community Center that's on Reese Street. You can see it from like Moot Hall. It's very close. We'll be marching students to the polls on that day and doing a get out the vote effort. So again, make sure November 3rd to get out there and cast your ballot. Polls typically open are open by 9 a.m. Some places open at 7 a.m. and they close at 9 p.m.
Don't they close at 6 and open at 6?
Open at 6.
Yeah.
Maybe 6.
Because I work as a poll worker.
All right.
So we have to be there at 5, and even the chickens aren't up that early.
Oh, my goodness. Well, I'm certainly not up that early.
All right. Thanks, Patty, and we'll get to Maddie. Go ahead.
So one last thing I just wanted to add about the events that we have going on for the higher ed campaign. So I'm going to be in the union tomorrow. I mentioned this earlier with a couple other kids that I work with. From 11 to 3, if you guys could come out, sign the petition, hopefully get this thing going. You guys could cut out a snowflake, write on the snowflake a reason that you think Governor Cuomo should freeze tuition hikes, and we'll take your picture, put it on social media. And yeah, that's about it.
And I just feel like I want to remind people that NYPIRG is a organization of student activists across New York State, and pretty much we work on different issues, trying to help the general public. So people should become aware of what we're trying to do, and they should want. I encourage people to get involved in anything or any campaign that they can involve that's working with NYPIRG.
Ooh, can I mention one last date too?
Yeah, go ahead.
So just going off of the Rev stuff, which we kicked off the day with, on November 4th at 6 p.m. At the Buffalo Public Library, the Public Service Commission will be hosting their next round of hearings on Rev. So I also encourage people to head to that. Have your voice heard there. Come visit us in the office to find out how to get down there, what some of the talking points are. So again, November 4th at 6 p.m. at the Public Library.
Oh, okay. And I was going to say room 419, check out the NYPIRG on room 419 at the Student Union.
We have chapter meetings every Tuesday at 5 in that room. If anybody wants to come and check us out, ask questions, we'd really love to have more students show up to these meetings.
Beautiful. I want to thank Patty and Maddie and Avery back there for coming from Nyberg. Enjoyed having all of you on the show today. And Jessica Kosick, any last word, the All Talk Monday coordinator?
I just wanted to remind everybody, I don't even know if that I've mentioned it on this show yet. This Saturday from 2 to 4 in the Buffalo Public Library, I have a project I've been working on all summer. It's my senior capstone. It's called Vanity Violence, the Survivor Monologues. It's from, again, like 2 to 4. Doors open at 1:30 for tabling. Again, all about domestic violence. And there's also an after party. If you check out Vanity Violence on Facebook, you can get more information about all of these things.
All right, and I just want to mention that I had some announcements, but Paul Smith, when he came in here, took them off the computer. but let me say, tonight at 5:30 at the Braun Trail Post, that's on Delaware and Kenmore, they're having the Clean Air Coalition is having a meeting on the Huntley Station at 5:30, the Huntley plant that's going to be closing up. What are we going to do with the tax base, and what are we going to do with the environmental coal pits and coal ash pits and stuff, and what's going on with all the workers? And also tomorrow at 7 o'clock at Buffalo State College here, room A209 of the classroom building, we're going to have Dr. Alan Lockwood's going to talk about air pollution, past, present, and future. So that's awesome. 7 to 9 at the classroom building, and that is free and open to the public, open to anybody. So I'll be there at that one, too. So A209 tomorrow at the classroom building. Once again, I guess we have to sign off because sports is next. And I'm going to leave you with some ABC News Now.